فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد آخر الأنبياء في الدنيا عصرا وأجلهم يوم القيامة شأنا وذكرا، صلى الله وملائكته والصالحون من خلقه كما وحد الله وعرف به ودعا إليه. أما بعد، we are in the sharh, the explanation of the book بلوغ المرام من أدلة الأحكام by الإمام الحافظ Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah. We are now on the second hadith inshallah ta'ala in the book of fasting. We took the first hadith. We are now on the second hadith in the chapter of fasting. وعن عمار بن ياسر رضي الله تعالى عنه قال من صام اليوم الذي يشك فيه فقد عصى أبا القاسم ذكره البخاري تعليقا ووصله الخمسة وصححه ابن خزيمة وابن الحبان. This hadith, Ammar ibn Yasir رضي الله تعالى عنه, he said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من صام, anyone who fasts, اليوم الذي يشك فيه, anyone who fasts, the day where there is doubt in it, فقد عصى أبا القاسم, that person has disobeyed the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. فقد عصى, that person has disobeyed أبا القاسم, أبا القاسم صلى الله عليه وسلم. He's disobeyed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This hadith, Imam al-Bukhari, he narrated it ta'liqan, mu'allaqan. And ta'liqan means we mentioned it last, in the last sit we mentioned it. Ta'liqan means Bukhari doesn't mention what? He doesn't mention his sheikh. هذا الحديث علقه البخاري كما ذكر المصنف. As the author said, Bukhari narrated this hadith mu'allaqan, without mentioning his sheikh. But Bukhari, what he does is, if he doesn't mention his sheikh, and he narrates a hadith, there are two methods in which he takes. بِصِيغَةِ الْجَزْمِ أَوْ صِيغَةُ التَّمْرِيضِ صِيغَةُ الْجَزْمِ أَوْ صِيغَةُ التَّمْرِيضِ صِيغَةُ الْجَزْمِ صِيغَةُ التَّمْرِيضِ means, he would either sometimes narrate that hadith which he hasn't mentioned his sheikh. So he's, the chain of narration is actually disconnected because Bukhari hasn't even mentioned his sheikh. He's either, number one, he's going to narrate it in an affirming manner, which is the first form. It's as though he's affirming it. That is the first form. The second one is, he narrates it بِصِيغَةِ التَّمْرِيضِ, which is as though this is said, and he doesn't affirm it with unwavering conviction. Okay? Those are the two manners in which Imam al-Bukhari would do. In this hadith, since he hasn't mentioned his sheikh, what form of the two has he taken? He narrated it بِصِيغَةِ الْجَزْمِ. صِيغَةِ الْجَزْمِ is what? He narrated it in a form of affirmation that this is correctly attributed to the Prophet. So why would Bukhari do that and not mention his sheikh? The reason he would is because, the reason why he would do that is because the narration is not part of his conditions. The narrators are not of his condition. So there is no need, or he doesn't see the reason for him to mention the chain. But as Hafiz Ibn Hajar mentions here, are you with me? Bukhari narrated mu'allaqan. And if you go to Alfiyatul Iraqi, for instance, you find the hadith which are in Bukhari and Muslim that are narrated mu'allaq, they're not dealt with. The mu'allaq is what? When the author doesn't mention his sheikh, as I said. The hadiths which are in Bukhari and Muslim that come in that way, the scholars, they kind of give it more respect than they do when it comes to other places. When it's in Bukhari and Muslim, it has the upper hand over other places. And that is why Iraqi said in his Alfiyah, وَقْطَعْ بِصِحَّةٍ لِمَا قَدْ أَثْنَدَى كَذَا لَهُ وَقِيلَ ظَنًّا وَالَدَى مُحَقِّقِيهِمْ قَدْ عَزَاهُ النَّوَوِي وَفِي الصَّحِيحِ بَعْضُ شَيْءٍ قَدْ رُوِي مُضَعَّفٌ وَلَهُمَا بِلَا سَنَدْ أشياء فإن يجزم فصحيح أو ورد ممرضا فلا ولكن يشعر بصحة الأصل له كي يذكر وإن يكن أول الإسناد حذف مع صيغة الجزم فتعليقا عرف ولو إلى آخره أما الذي لشيخه عزاب قال فاكذي عنعانة كخبر المعازف لا تصغي لابن حزم المخالف. So the narrations that are in Bukhari and Muslim which come in that form, the scholars, they give it the upper hand. Very good. Which chain did Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, did he narrate this hadith mu'allaqan? In which chain did he narrate it in that form of ta'liq? It is through the chain of Silah ibn Zufar al-Absi, who is from the Kibar al-Tabi'een, in which Hafiz ibn Hajar said about him in his taqrib, Thiqatun Jalilun, he is an honorable person, a highly respected individual. And the five, they all brought this hadith, all of them, they brought it with its chain, meaning Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Al-Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, Ibn Khuzaymah, Ibn Hibban. All of them, they brought it with its chain of narration connected. وَوَصَلَهُ الْخَمْسَةِ Abu Dawud narrated in Kitab, in the book of fasting, بَابُ كَرَاهِيَةِ الصَّوْمِ يَوْمُ الشَّكِ. Tirmidhi also narrated in his book of fasting, بَابُ مَا جَاءَ فِي كَرَاهِيَةِ الصَّوْمِ يَوْمُ الشَّكِ. Nasa'i also the same, Ibn Majah also the same, Ibn Khuzaymah also the same, and Ibn Hibban also the same. And Imam Hakim in his Mustadrak also the same. All of them, they narrated it from the chain of narration. They narrated it from the chain of narration of Amr ibn Qais al-Mula'i. All of them, they narrated from Abi Khalid al-Ahmar Sulaiman ibn Hayyan, who narrated from Amr ibn Qais al-Mula'i, who narrated from Abi Ishaq al-Sabi'i, عن صلة ibn Zufar al-Absi. All of them. And Imam al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah classified this hadith to be sahih. And since Tirmidhi has an upper hand over Ibn Khuzaymah and his Ibn Hibban, it would have been better on the side of Hafiz ibn Hajar to bring the authentication of Tirmidhi before bringing us the authentication of Ibn Khuzaymah and Ibn Hibban. Yeah? It would have been better. This hadith Imam Hakim narrated in his Mustadrak, and it's a hadith which is sahih, and it's upon the conditions of Bukhari and Muslim, but they didn't bring it out. And also Dhahabi agreed to that. Very good. Let's look at the mistake that Hafiz ibn Hajar fell into when he said, وَوَصَلَهُ الْخَمْسَةُ The five, they connected it. He should have said the four connected it. The correct was what? The wahmun. It's a mistake that is on the side of who? Hafiz ibn Hajar. Because this hadith, only Ashabu Sunan al-Arba'a, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, and Nasa'i are the ones who brought the full connected chain of narration. Imam Ahmad did not mention in his Musnad. And remember when Hafiz ibn Hajar said that, he said, he's going to say the five are referring to who? Imam Ahmad in there, right? Imam Ahmad doesn't have it in his Musnad, this chain of hadith connected. Even if you go to the Atraf, you won't find it in there as well. Are you with me? Hafiz ibn Hajar himself kind of refuted himself in his own Fathul Bari. Because he mentioned all the people who connected this hadith, and he never mentioned Imam Ahmad's Musnad in his Fathul Bari, the fourth volume, Page 120. So that's the first mistake that's there on the Sheikh side. Also, the other point that was is a deficiency on the side of the author Ibn Hajar is a lot of scholars authenticated this hadith. Al-hadithu qad sahahu jam'un min al-a'imma. A large amount of scholars, they authenticated it. And he only mentioned two of them who authenticated it. He mentioned who? Ibn Khuzaymah and Ibn Hibban. Only. But he didn't bring the tasheeh of At-Tirmidhi. He didn't bring the authentication of At-Tirmidhi. Even though the At-Tirmidhi brought it and authenticated it. Are you with me? And this in reality, وَهَذَا يُعْتَبَرُ قُصُورٌ فِي التَّخْرِيجِ. This is a deficiency in when you do ilm, when you study the science of takhrij of hadith. And this is one of the مُخَالَفَةُ الْإِحْدَى قَوَاعِدِهِ الْمُسْتَقَرَّةِ فِيهِ. It's one of the well-known principles that are followed when you're doing takhrij of hadith. And that is when you're doing takhrij of hadith, if a hadith is in the أُمَّهَاتُ السِّتَّةِ, the six hadiths, and then that should be given precedence over it. And their grading should be given precedence over anything that comes after it. These six books. Very good. غريب الحديث ومفرداتي. We finished the issue of pertaining to the narration and the sciences pertaining to the narration. And that is slightly the hardest part since we discussed this issue. But now we're going to move on to the second part, which is we're going to now talk about the fiqh pertaining to the hadith. But before I go into the fiqh, we always have to do a stop over what? A bit about the grammatical analysis and whatnot, okay? Or the language that are in it, or the strange words that are used. The narration says, "Man sama, anyone who fasts, al-yawmu alladhi yushakku." So this is mabniyu lil majhul. It is what? Mabniyu lil majhul. Mabniyu lil majhul means the one who has done the action is not mentioned. It's a verb. That the one who has done the action is not mentioned. The subject isn't mentioned. The person who has done this action is not mentioned. And that is the narration of Al-Imam al-Tirmidhi al-Nasa'i, which it comes as Al-Yawmu alladhi yushakku fihi. That is the narration of Al-Tirmidhi al-Nasa'i. But there's a benefit in it when you say Al-Yawmu alladhi yushakku fihi. There's a benefit in it. The benefit that it is in it, which is al-yawmu alladhi yushakku fi. The hadith also brings the ism mawsool, the connective, which is alladhi. The connective alladhi is mentioned. Al-yawm, the day. Alladhi, the day, yushakku, there is doubt in it. Al-Imam al-Tibi in his kitab al-kashif al-haqa'iq al-sunan, he mentions إِنَّمَا أَتَى بِالْإِسْمِ الْمَوْصُولِ أَمَ إِنَّمَا أُوْتِيَ بِالْإِسْمِ الْمَوْصُولِ. The ism mawsool was brought وَلَمْ يَقُلْ, and the one who, and it wasn't said يَوْمُ الشَّكْ, the day of doubt, wasn't said. It was said يَوْمُ الَّذِي يُشَكْ. The reason is because مُبَالَغَةً, it's to go overboard فِي أَنَّ صَوْمَ يَوْمُ يُشَكُّ فِي أَدْنَ الشَّكْ سَبَبُ الْعِسَانِ أَبِ الْقَاسِمِ. It is actually the intent of saying of yawmu, the day, alladhi, that day, yushakku fihi, that there's doubt in it, to try to say that if there's even slight doubt, let's try to go extreme, even if there is slight doubt in you, then this is a disobedience to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What about the one who fasts a day when there is doubt in it? Are you with me? A lot of doubt in it. And the doubt is present in him. And the example for that example, which is اليوم الذي يشك فيه, is like Surah Hud, Ayah 113, where Allah says, وَلَا تَرْكَنُوا إِلَى الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا فَتَمَسَّكُمُ النَّارِ. Don't divert and deviate towards the oppressors, because then the hellfire will touch you. It means, don't divert to anyone who has the slightest, the most minimum oppression in them. Don't go to them. What about if the person whose oppression is consistent in them? فَكَيْفَ بِالظَّالِمِ الْمُسْتَمِرِ عَلَيْهِ. Are you with me? That is very important. That is why the ism mawsool is there and the benefit that it has it being there. Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, in his narration, his wording, he brought it with the word of يوم الشك. So he says, من صام اليوم ومن صام يوم الشك, the one who fasts the day of doubt. And that is the last day of Sha'ban. The last day of, وهو آخر يوم من شعبان. It's the last day of Sha'ban. Even that though, the scholars, they differed whether it's going to be on what? If it's going to be the first day of Ramadan, or is it on the 30th of Sha'ban? But they all agree it's on the 20th, after the 29th. Is it going to be on the 30th, or is it going to be on the first, that day of doubt? Which one is it going to be? We'll speak about that inshallah ta'ala when we go into the fiqh of the hadith. The hadith also says, so anyone who fasts the day which there is doubt in it, فَقَدْ عَصَى, he has disobeyed أَبَا الْقَاسِمِ. أَبَا الْقَاسِمِ, أَبَا الْقَاسِمِ is a kunya. It's a kunya. Kunya means when you're attributed to your son, the father of so and so. Okay? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was referred to as Abu al-Qasim because of his oldest son. لِوَلَدِهِ الْأَكْبَرِ, his oldest son. His oldest son was Qasim. That was the oldest son he had from the children of Khadija. And it was said that Abu Qasim died before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent out as a messenger. And then Ibrahim was born for him in Medina from his wife Maria. Are you with me? And the Sahabas, a lot of the times they used to refer to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as Abu al-Qasim. They used to refer to him. مَا كَانُوا يُكْنُونَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ بِأَبِي الْقَاسِمِ, as it's in this hadith. And the Arabs are very well known. They're very well known. عُرِفَ عِنْدَ الْعَرَبِي مِنْ أَنَّ مُنَادَاتِ الْإِنسَانِ بِالْكُنْيَةِ مِنْ بَابِ التَّعْظِيمِ. Referring to a person by their kunya is from the angle of honoring them, really. As the poet said, أَكْنِيهِ حِينَ أُنَادِيهِ لِأُكْرِمَهُ وَلَا أُلَقِّبُهُ وَالسَّوْءَةُ اللَّقَبُ. He said, I refer to him by his kunya when I want to call him so I can honor him. And I don't give him a nickname because a nickname is something evil to do. And it was narrated in Bukhari and Muslim on the authority of Anas ibn Malik that a man called the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam whilst the Prophet was in Baqi'. He called the Prophet. Or more like he called the name Abu al-Qasim whilst the Prophet was in Baqi'. He said, Abu al-Qasim. And this was in Baqi'. فَالْتَفَتَ إِلَيْهِ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, the Prophet looked at him. And when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at him, فَقَالِ يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, he said, O Messenger of Allah, لَمْ أَعْنِكَ, I didn't intend you. I did not what? I didn't intend you. إِنَّمَا دَعَوْتُ فُلَانًا, I was only calling so and so. Are you with me? Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, تسمو باسمي, take my name if you want, Muhammad. وَلَا تُكْنَوْ, وَلَا تَكْ, وَلَا تُكْنُوْ, أما وَلَا تُكَنُوْ, that's it, correct way of saying it. وَلَا تُكَنُوْ بِكُنْيَتِي, وَلَا تُكَنُوْ بِكُنْيَتِي, and do not give yourself as a nickname, my nickname. My Abu al-Qasim, don't take that as a name. Take my name Muhammad as your name, but don't take yourselves as Abu al-Qasim. Don't take yourselves as what? Abu al-Qasim. Are you with me? So, and there's that hadith. Now we're going to go into the fiqh of the hadith and the benefits that we can take of the hadith. Number one, the fiqh that we can take from the hadith. The fiqh that we can take from the hadith. Number one. Is this hadith, is this hadith the Prophet says sallallahu alayhi wa sallam statement, or is it the statement of a companion? Look at the wording. وعن عمار بن ياسر رضي الله تعالى عنه قال من صام اليوم الذي يشك فيه فقد عصى أبا القاسم صلى الله عليه وسلم. If you look at it, عمار بن ياسر didn't even attribute it to the Prophet. He did not what? He did not attribute it to the Prophet. So, can we say that this hadith is graded as though it's the Prophet's statement, or is it a statement of Ammar ibn Yasir? The scholars, they differ on this. The scholars, اختلف أهل العلم في هذا الحديث. The scholars, they differed on this hadith, and they also differed on the a hadith like this, which the Sahabi places a ruling on something by saying this is a sin. By saying that this is a sin, a companion will come and he would say this is a sin, or this is a obedience, or this is disbelief. هل يعد مرفوعا أو موقوفا? Can this be مرفوع or is it موقوف? So pay attention to this question. This is a very important question. If a companion comes and he places over a particular issue, he places over it obedience or disobedience, you see, or he says this is disbelief, can this now then be said that this is the Prophet's statement? And can he be given the ruling of the Prophet ﷺ? Or it's clearly the companion and it can't be lifted over to no one else. This is the dispute. Scholars say, فَمِنْ مَنْ رَجَّحَ وَقْفَهُ. There are those scholars who said this is mawquf. Mawquf meaning it stops at the companion. He can't, this is not the Prophet. It can't be attributed to the Prophet. The scholars who said that is Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah rahimahullah in his kitab Tahdhib al-Sunan. He took that opinion. And he attributed that opinion to a group of people, a group of scholars. Also Hafidh ibn Hajar himself. Al-Jawhari al-Maliki. Also Sirajuddin al-Bulqini. As a side benefit, many people they say Sirajuddin al-Bulqini. But the correct way of saying inshallah ta'ala is Sirajuddin al-Bulqini. Sirajuddin al-Bulqini, by the way, is the teacher of Hafidh ibn Hajar. And we mentioned it in the beginning when we was talking about his biography. Yeah. And remember when Hafidh ibn Hajar, when he says in his Fathul Bari, he says, قال شيخ الإسلام, who is he referring to? Sirajuddin al-Bulqini. He's referring to Sirajuddin al-Bulqini, that's his teacher. He has a book called Mahasin al-Istilah, which is a Mustalah Hadith book. It's called Mahasin al-Istilah. He also took that opinion as well. He took the opinion, which is what? That if a companion places over a matter that it's a sin, or it's disbelief, or whatnot, it takes the ruling of it being attributed to that companion and that it doesn't take. And what's the benefit of us saying that it's attributed to the companion of the Prophet? The benefit that comes from it is if it comes from the Prophet, it takes a stronger ruling. You're not allowed to disobey the Prophet. But if it's attributed to a companion, then all it requires is another companion opposing him, and then it's what? You look at who's stronger, okay? His statement. So that's why it's important. والقول الثاني في المسألة, the second of speech or the second view is, and I believe it's the راجح, I think it's the strongest view, inshallah, if Allah wills, بإذن الله الكريم, that is من قبيل المرفوع حكما, that it takes the ruling of it being attributed to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. It can be correctly attributed to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. So it becomes موقوف لفظا مرفوع حكما. Its wording is attributed to the companion, but the ruling is attributed to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. So this we call it what? موقوف لفظا مرفوع حكما. And the reason is because we can't attribute to a companion that he would be so excessive in placing a particular matter that it's a sin or is disbelief without having heard it from the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. And this opinion, Hafidh ibn Hajar took it as well. He took that in his Nukat. He mentions that in his Nukat. Also Ibn Abdul Barr. Al-Imam al-Hakim al-Naysaburi. He also took that view as well. Also Fakhruddin al-Razi, he mentions that view as well in his Mahsul. Zarkashi in his Nukat ala Muqaddamat ibn al-Salah. So you can, if I'm not wrong, Imam al-Sakhawi rahimahullah, Shamsuddin al-Sakhawi, he also mentions it in his kitab Fath al-Mughith, which is a sharh of Alfiyat al-Iraqi, which is a sharh of what? Alfiyat al-Hadith. So it's called Fath al-Mughith bi sharh Alfiyat al-Hadith by Imam al-Iraqi. If I'm also not wrong, Suyuti, he took that view in his Jalalu, in his kitab Tadrib al-Rawi. Jalaluddin al-Suyuti, he took that opinion also in his Tadrib al-Rawi.